Hi, I'm Stefan, the organizer and host of the EMBO++, the next level conference for embedded software developers. And thanks to Leica Geosystems, you can watch this talk online for free.
Okay, then I'll start with my talk. I'm on embedded CMake for a heterogeneous system. Welcome. Thanks a lot for starting my talk. I hope you can hear me. Can I get a short feedback? If it's all working, if you can see my slides and if you hear me, yeah, thanks a lot. Great, yeah. So basically, what I show you in the next couple of minutes is our experience of transforming our embedded project into a CMake setup, and you'll later see what were our challenges, what are the benefits, and still some issues we are facing, but just a walkthrough of our experience using CMake. Some words about myself. I studied automotive engineering here in Stuttgart. During that time, I could do some working experience, mainly in the automotive industry at Bosch, Aston Martin, and Porsche. And then I did a PhD on simulation-based validation of advanced driver assistance systems. That was a shared work. On the one hand, I studied at University of Stuttgart, but was working at ITAS, which is a subsidiary of the Bosch Group. There I later on continued working as a software developer for C++-based simulation models. And currently I'm working as a software developer for IMO at Stiel. IMO, that's the little autonomous mower you see there in the background of the slide. So that's our product. That's what I'm working on every day. Maybe some of you already have such things driving around in your garden and mowing your grass. That's what we are developing also. And I give some lectures on software development at University of Stuttgart. Okay, so short overview of what I'm going to present now. So a quick overview of what CMake is. I think many of you here in the conference know CMake, maybe not all, so I just give a brief overview of what CMake is and what it's used for. Then our specific challenge, so to give you an idea of what our system is made of. And then the main part is our approaches and the lessons learned. There we talk about the transfer to CMake, the target structure we're using, how we use different targets, mainly executable, static, and interface targets, how we're using non-CMake libraries, then some words about helper targets, components, and installation. And one part is CI setup and variant handling. We have multiple variants we're supporting, and a short summary. I'll have two sections in my talk where we see some live codes. The code I'll show you later where you get it. It's on GitHub, so you can use it for yourself if you're interested. Okay, so CMake overview. What is it and why are we using it? So I think the general idea of what CMake is, it's a tool you can install and download. It also has a GUI if you prefer using a GUI. But basically, the core element is you have so-called CMake list files. And there you describe what are your source files, how you want to compile them. And CMake is then capable of generating multiple build outputs, so to say. You can generate GNU make files, different projects, you can cross-compile, and so you're not bound to a specific IDE or setup, but whatever you describe in your CMake list is quite cross-platform. And one of the core ideas of CMake, at least how it's used nowadays, is our so-called targets. A target can be something executable or library, whatever, but a target knows about its source files, its include directories, its compile flags, its dependencies, and so on. So a target, that's quite a core concept of what CMake is about. There are different target types. You can have executable, static, dynamic, interface targets. There are some more, but I stick to them for a minute. And those different targets, they can depend on each other. So you can have executable target A depends on a static target B, C, and D, and they themselves can again depend on other target types. Just to get the idea, okay, those are the main elements, building blocks of what CMake is made of, and every target can have source files, compiler flags, include directories, etc. Those arrows between the targets, they are the dependencies, and CMake knows about some different target dependency types. Here's a short example. We can have a static library called libb. We have three static libraries called libA. And then we have three different executables. And now let's assume this first connection, that's not so interesting, that all the executables depend on library A privately. Here are the differences. So on the first column, we see executable A depends on libA, and libA depends on libB privately. So in this case, app A does not know about libB and its internals, because libB is private to libA. Okay. For the executable app B, it knows about libB and its internals, because libB is a public dependency to libA. And the third one, app C, also knows about libB and its internals. It's quite similar. In this case, interface means it's not really used by libA. It's you can think of this interface dependency like such a private dependency from app C to libB. Okay, that's just as a little overview of the dependency types between CMake targets. And the next thing I would like to show is our CMake toolchains. So one common problem, especially in the embedded area and unit testing and so on, is we have to target different systems. Here again, the graphic, we have CMake list describing what we are compiling and our targets. It runs through CMake, and we generate something for our system A, which requires a certain compiler. If we want to do the same thing, but target a different system with a different compiler, there are so-called toolchains, which you can use to tell CMake some specifics about your compiler or the system you're targeting for. And we're using all that stuff we've seen currently in our CMake setup. And that's now the end of the little CMake overview. And let's apply all of that to our system. So our challenge, what was it? What is the system we're building off made of? So it's a, I've called it multi-system setup. Here we have three, for our example project here, we have three different systems. System A, which requires a specific compiler, system B, and system C. System C, in our example project here, that's a non-embedded target. The other ones are embedded targets. And we have quite a lot of source code. On the one hand, we have some common code here down at the bottom. That's code that's shared across all systems. And we have some system-specific source code. Here, this part is used in system A only, and this part is used in system B only. And some of those files can only be compiled for system A. So like specific drivers, they are not cross-platform compatible. They are for system A only and not for system B and system C. So that's all the part of our challenge. Okay. The common source code now, it depends a bit. It's used across all different systems, but we require to compile it with different compile flags regarding whichever system it's later used in. So if you use the common source code in system A, we need specific compiler flags and defines. If you use the common source code in system B, it needs different compiler flags. And if we use it for our unit testing or for system C, it again needs different compile flags. So that was one of the challenges we were facing. So in the end, we want to have executables for our embedded targets, embedded A, embedded B. That's how we later we call it in our demo project here. And of course, we have a test code for all of the three different aspects. And those are part of the unit test on the right side for our system C. Yeah. That's mainly what the multi-system setup is made of. And to make it a bit more complicated, we have variants. So we have system A dash and system B dash, which are almost the same as system A, but not exactly the same. So there are some minor specifics for those variants, and we want to build them too. We want to have a similar executable. I've named it the same, so it's embedded A and embedded A for both system A and system A dash, and for system B it's the same. So mainly that were all the issues or challenges we were facing. Now I'll show you how we solved those, and we'll go through some code in a minute. So what were our approaches and the lessons learned? When we were transferring to CMake, we are quite a big and heterogeneous team with different preferences. So on the other hand, we have a common repository, and we wanted to be quite CI friendly. And in all three aspects, CMake helped to manage us, this approach. So CMake allowed us to support different development setups. So up to now, we still allow all our developers to use different setups, whatever they are more comfortable with. And we have a common repository for all the different systems. So CMake allowed us to clearly and Git-friendly specify all compiler flags, setups by using a single and dedicated description. So those CMake list files, they were really the one key aspect to unify and, as described here, to store it in a common repository in a very... way. And the last aspect, the CI friendliness. So CMake allowed us to use the same setup for local development and CI builds, which I really prefer not to have different setups for the CI or for local development. It should be as homogeneous as possible. So some words about our target structure. Here again, we see the three different systems, and we use three different tool chains. So as described earlier, the tool chain there, we describe which compiler to use, which specific flags to add for a certain system. And we build the executables for system A and system B. And now, the first interesting target is the common target. So those are the common source files used across all different systems, and we realized it by using an interface target. So an interface target, that's a CMake target that gets not compiled directly. So more or less, it's a group of source files, include directories, compile flags, and so on. But the interface target itself is not compiled. It only gets compiled if it's linked against or if it an executable has a dependency to it. So one nice thing about these interface targets is that the target properties from executables influence its compilation. And from a naming perspective, we all call all our interface targets raw targets, just to signalize or to signal that's not compiled yet. To test this, we have an executable test common for the system C. Yeah, that's quite straightforward. Then we have some source files which are specific to our system A. We use an interface target. We call it A raw. We have tests, and our embedded executable depends on the A raw interface target. The same holds for B. We have B-specific executable, B-specific source files. We have the interface target B raw, and unit tests for this target. And if we have some specific source code that's not cross-platform compatible, like some low-level drivers, then they are part of the executable directly. One thing we still have, which does not fit into this clean setup, are static imported libraries. The main drawback when using static libraries, a static library is compiled. So if we have to compile our static library for our embedded for our system A, to use it in the embedded A executable, it's not really cross-platform compatible for example, system C. We manage to use 10 different libraries, but that's whenever we can avoid it, we try to avoid it using statically imported libraries and prefer raw source code. Okay, just a short overview of the different targets, executable targets. Okay, that's these are the final executables to be executed on dedicated systems. Here we define our system relevant compile flex. And if we go a slide back, that's one nice thing about those interface targets. So on the executable target embedded A, we can define certain compiler flags, which then influence interface target A raw or interface common raw and their compilations. So, which in the end, of course, we have to compile common raw twice if we use embedded A and if we use it in embedded B, but we have the flexibility to define different compile flags. So static libraries or static targets, they define target-relevant compile flags directly. The compile flag of dependent targets do not influence source file compilation. Okay, that's clear because the static target is defined and a specific static target is unsuited for multiple different systems as it's already compiled. Therefore, we have the interface, or we're using the CMake interface targets, which define also target-relevant compile flags. And the depending targets do influence its source file compilation, and a specific interface target can be used for multiple different systems as it's not yet compiled. Okay, how are we handling different non-CMake libraries? Okay, I mentioned it already. We try to make CMake targets for everything wherever possible. So for non-CMake libraries, we create dedicated CMake targets, preferably an interface target. If that's not possible, we have to use multiple static imported libraries if it's pre-compiled already, but we try to avoid it as mentioned already. Okay, now I would like to introduce the example project. It's the same we saw on the slide already. You can get it on GitHub. It's you can find it on the Craft Coder and then Modern Embedded CMake for a Heterogeneous System as this talk. It's called exactly. So I'll switch over to Visual Studio Code. I think we've seen it quite a couple of times already. That's also our build setup. I'll shortly introduce the directory structure and then we go through the CMake file just to get an impression of what it's made of. So this VS Code directory, we mainly can ignore it. I just would like to show here, I've just made a CMake kits file to use three different kits for three different example system here now, Clang C++ 20, GCC C++ 17, C11, and Linux GCC ARM HF. Those naming here, I'm using a submodule called Poly, which is also a GitHub repository, which has a bunch of toolchain files defined. Just three examples here for the three different systems we've seen. Okay, that's the only submodule that's used in this repository. And then we have the source directory. Here we have the three main components. It's a common area. We have the source code defined that's used commonly. Something for the B target and something for the A target. So each of this directory has a subdirectory called tests. And there we have defined all the targets we've seen in the slide. Now I'll go shortly through the CMake files to give you an example of what it's made of. Okay, that's our EMBO example. We include some print helpers and C tests. Later on, I'll say something about our variant handling, how this is used. We set a default installation path. Okay, not so interesting. We print the variant variable, and we have some helper targets. I'll say a word about this later also. And here we add our three subdirectories, the common, the A, and the B targets. Okay, let's go through the common stuff. Here we have our CMake list file, and we add an interface target. So it's called common raw. It has source called print.cpp and some compile definitions and include directory. Let's have a short look into this print.cpp file. It has a simple print function, takes a string and is in the namespace EMBO. And the print.cpp, now here we have all the challenges we were facing. So we have here multiple precompiler definitions. If defined A, then we print out compiled for A. If defined B, we print out compiled for B, else we print out compiled for undefined, then we print the variant, and the actual printing function says hello from something. Okay, and here you see, depending on which compile flags are defined, the print method itself behaves a bit differently. Okay, now for the tests, it's a simple executable. It links the common raw, and it gets added as a test. Okay, so now the same holds for the A and B targets. I shortly open those one. We have an A raw target, which links the common raw. Then we have the embedded A executable, which has a main CPP file and links to the A raw target. Exactly. The rest I'll show later. And each of those has tests as well. So I shortly configure the CMake project here. You see here down below, we currently use the toolchain Clang C++ 20. We print out some information here that we're using this toolchain we are building for variant number one. And exactly, we can now here for example, builds the embedded target A. And we see if we build an embedded target A, it compiles the print.cpp file and the main.cpp. If we now compile a different target, for example, embedded B, it again has to compile the print.cpp file as its target specific. Okay, so we see here it again had to compile two files, main.cpp and print.cpp. That's fine so far because we were using it as interface targets. Okay, so that as a first overview of the example project. I go back to the target structure here, and just a few words about the additional custom targets we're using here. We realized it's a pretty common use case to compile all executables for system A, or to compile all executables for system B, or to compile all unit tests. So we created custom targets called all system A, all system B, and all tests, which have we just depend on the on those targets. Our system has some more executables for system A, but I think the basic idea is quite clear. So now you can build all tests, and only all tests get compiled and can be executed. This is quite nice regarding installation. So we use the same setup. We say we have components which have the same name as those custom targets. For example, a component called system B. And now you can, within your cmakelist.txt file, you can describe an installation command which says, please add embedded B to the installation targets for component all system B. And then this command, cmake install, use a certain build directory and component all system B, you then only install whatever was compiled for all system B. And by this setup, we manage to have a common CMake setup for all different systems. But building for system B with our toolchain B only, which of course speeds up our CI and compilation process quite a bit. That also leads me to our CI setup and variant handling approach. So just a few words about our branching schema. So I think it's a quite common scheme. We're using a master and develop branch, mainly working on the develop branch with feature branches, parallel setups, and go back via pull request. Then we create our release branch, develop stuff there or fix, mainly do some hot fixes or bug fixes there till we say, okay, it's ready to release. And then we create tags on the master branch, which stands for our release then. And CMake here allowed us to set up a CI build for every commit. We are building multiple variants. We execute all the unit tests on every commit with the documentation added to CMake. We have multiple variants, as mentioned already, and we have the same setup for local and the CI builds. And it allowed us to give quite a fast feedback to the developers. And how was it realized for the variant handling? So basically what we are doing, we have one large repository. We have a CI pipeline running on our build server, and it spits out multiple variants. And the variant handling itself is set up this way. So we have a repository, and we create dedicated build directories for each system, as you see here. For example, we build for system A, build for system B, and build for system C with different compilers, but we install it into variant-specific directories. So we install, so let's assume we build for variant 1. Then we build system A, system B, system C. All three build directories are created, all systems are built, and it's all installed into directory variant number 1. Then if we iterate and build variant number 2, those build directories exist already. So we strongly use the CMake caching mechanism here and rebuild only what's different between variant 1 and variant 2. So we iterate over the build directories again, build everything system A, system B, and system C, and build variant number 2. And the same for variant number 3. And yeah, by this way, we make use of the CMake caching mechanism because it only rebuilds whatever is necessary for different variants and have a quite clear output for the...
Wir sind hier in einem kleineren Grossraumbüro.
Bei den Leuten habe ich die Freiheit, dass ich, wenn ich anfange und wenn ich höre mit dem Arbeiten, eigentlich kann selber einteilen kann.
Overall, how I will do it, it's just up to me and they give me a lot of freedom.
Für mich ist die Faszination, mit anderen Leuten einen kreativen Moment zu generieren.
Great colleagues, great environment basically.
it's really nice here and I don't have any issues living here.
Am meisten schätze ich in der Leica G-Systems, dass wir ein sehr junges Team sind, sowie dass ich auch meine Arbeitszeit in einem gewissen Umfang selber bestimmen kann.
And I could merge in my life hobby with my office job.
Das Besondere an der Leica G-Systems ist sicher die Kultur und die Dynamik, die es gibt in dem Team. Es ist jeden Tag ein bisschen anders.
We have a good organization which will help you to get used to the company in the first couple of months especially.
Das ist sehr interessant und ja, macht mir Spaß.
Three variants. Yeah. So, I see there was a question. How do you tag multiple unrelated systems on a single Git repo? I hope the next code answers this a bit more clearly. So here I've created an example main build script. So what we can see here, we can ignore the first few lines, and then from line 10 ongoing we have the main for loop for our different variants. So I say here we have variant number one and variant number two, and we print out some information that we're now building variant one. And we're using those different tool chains. I've called it here build kit just to use the same wording as VS Code is using it. So I define a build kit which uses a specific CMake tool chain. And it uses the, let's have a closer look at this line number 18, the CMake command. So as a source directory, we're using the current directory, so the root of our repository, and we use a specific toolchain file. So in this case, just an example toolchain from the poly submodule, gcc, blah, 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 dot CMake. So that's our toolchain file for the first system. We pass it the compile or the CMake variable variant, and we build it into its dedicated build directory. And this we're making three times. So we call the same thing, the same CMake command, but using a different toolchain and a different build directory. And the third time with a different toolchain and a different build directory. So in this example, let's assume those are the embedded targets. Here we build all system A. That's an embedded target. We build all system B. And the last one, here we build all the tests running on our main machine. And the install commands, they now say, okay, please install whatever you build in this build directory into this target directory. So install variant, install only the component all system A, and install config release. Okay. Same we're doing for system B. We say install from this build directory into this install directory, and everything from component all system B. And the third part of this iteration, we are not installing anything, but we execute our tests. Okay, now I shortly run this script, and we see, okay, we're starting to build variant one. It's configuring CMake. The first build is through already, the second, now the third, playing C++ 20, and the tests were executed. Now the iteration, we are building variant number two. Everything, all three steps get executed, the tests get executed, and it's done. So let's have a look at what was created. So we now have three different build directories. I think the first one, that's the GCC C++ 17 C11, then this cross-compiler Linux GCC ARMHF, and the Clang C++ 20 compiler. So we have a dedicated build directory for every toolchain or for every target system. And we then have two variants. So embedded A, which was built using this first toolchain, was installed in variant 1 and in variant 2 also. The embedded B was installed for both variants, and we don't have anything installed for tests. They were executed locally only. Okay, if now just as a last example, I'll add the verbose flag to the test executable output, and we'll run it again. And then we can see the dependencies of those interface targets related to the test output. As if you can remember, we just have a short look at the printcpp function again. It behaves differently compared to the different compile flags. And A gets defined at the executable target embedded A. We see it here. Target compile definitions A raw interface A. Okay, it gets defined here on the A raw target. So if we execute the tests for A raw, we would expect this print CPP function to have the A defined. And that's what we can see now here in the test output. It's now a bit more verbose. It was the same build script again. So here we first execute our tests common. And here we say compiled for undefined variant 2. Okay, tests common. It has not A, it has neither A nor B defined, so it prints compiled for undefined. It says hello from tests common. Okay. Now we have the tests for our A raw section or raw target. It's compiled for A variant 2. It says hello from test A. And let's have a short look how this main.cpp. So that's mainly the test that was executed here. We have a simple main function, and we just call our print function passing the string test A. And that was then the output. It was compiled for target A, variant number 2, hello from test A. And the same holds for B. It was compiled for B, variant 2, and we get hello from test B. And if we scroll up a bit, the first iteration, the tests were executed also, and there everything was compiled for variant number 1. Okay, so that was now quite a bit of different variants and mixing of build systems, but I think the essence is that we have to target three different systems and multiple variants, and the CMake setup I was presenting now managed us to handle those different types of this quite complex setup in a straightforward way. Yeah. Okay. So as a short summary, CMake allowed us to target this heterogeneous system I already showed. We have multiple embedded and also the non-embedded targets executing the unit tests. We could cleanly specify target properties no matter for which system they were, if they were embedded or non-embedded. And it's very Git friendly, so it was easy to merge those CMake files if multiple persons are working on them. It was quite straightforward to support CI and local build setups. So we got great automation and different IDEs and operating systems for the developers. And due to using those, the build structure I presented, it greatly improved our build times due to the target-based parallelization, which CMake handles automatically. If it detects those targets are independent to each other, then it can be built parallel. And this variant caching I've presented. Okay. So again, you can find the example code on GitHub. And thanks a lot for your attention, and I'm happy to answer some further questions if you have any. Here, I think I've seen one that was not yet answered. Looking at the script, do I understand it correctly that some combination of toolchain and target might not be valid compiled? So that's a great question. Our approach here is that we allow to configure everything for every system. That's right, but not compiling everything for every system. So you're completely right. Not every target can be compiled using every toolchain or every combination. That's right. So the CMake configure should run on no matter which system you are, but the compilation itself will not work for every target. But that's how we wanted to design, or that was part of the design. That, for example, the embedded A target is compiled using toolchain A for system A, but not for the executable. Does not make sense to be compiled for non-embedded target, for example. Absolutely right. Okay. Then thanks a lot, and have a good day. See you later.
If you found this video informative, make sure to subscribe our channel. Click the thumbs up if you liked it, or leave us a comment on what we could improve. If you are looking for a job in the embedded industry, or you've got one to offer, drop us a mail to jobs@embo.io. That's jobs@embo.io. And we'll make sure that you match up. My name is Stefan Bückelmann, and as long as you keep watching, we'll keep covering the internals of the embedded industry.